My name is Caroline Wayne, as you've just heard, and I'm going to begin this talk with the conclusions that I'm going to reach at the end. First and foremost, I have to say I am an avid fan of books, and I think that there are 8 of us in the whole of the RSC that work and are dedicated to working on books, and we believe passionately that books have their place and that primary literature is not the be-all and end-all. And even within our own organisation, we have to repeat that mantra over and over again. And I think that it's one of the things that e-book developments have suffered from over the last few years is there's been so much value laid on primary literature and what it brings to the end user that people have forgotten that books serve a function too. They're a different type of content and they do something special for the end user. On that note, no one size fits all and e-books are still evolving. We're going to carry on seeing evolving e-books for probably another 10, 15, 20 years. But what my presentation is about today is that small and medium-sized academic publishers shouldn't let that evolution put them off stepping into the e-book market and profiting from the opportunities which are here and now in 2009. So I want to talk a little bit about RSC Book Publishing in 2006, which was when I joined the organisation. We had a trusted learned society and professional body, very well respected within the UK and very well regarded outside, strong international journal publisher brand, and a fantastic world-class database of authors, and a very, very profitable journals programme. So one would assume we would have a fantastic loss-making books programme. Fortunately, we're a society, which means we have an obligation, we have a royal charter, and our journals had to support our books, and they did for around about 5 years. They supported a loss-making programme, and we carried on, and everyone was scratching their heads, what are we going to do with this programme? We had a look at the product types. Was the problem there? Is it professional references, advanced textbooks, handbooks? We had a look at the market. We talked to our end users. Everyone said, no, that's really what we want. So we thought, right, we've pitched the different levels of content. Is it perhaps what's in the books, the subject areas? We went out, we did some extensive market research, some of which concluded last year, looking at essentially a roadmap for science and the chemical sciences. And everything that came up in that appears here on this screen, and we were publishing in that. So we were really kind of confused and wondering what's going on. It's not editorial's fault. Acquisitions, again, a nice international spread, as you'd think in an academic British Royal Society. We have a high proportion of UK contributors, but that's actually from 2006. It's changed quite a lot in the last 2 years. Distribution and marketing. This is where the problems were really arising for books. We have a fantastic online sales team for journals. But books was entirely print distribution. We had one person trying to handle 600 accounts worldwide. Very expensive and very time-consuming print-only marketing. Anyone in this room that's ever been involved in a books catalogues will have learned that lesson that you stay well away the following year. And a substandard website, which was very difficult to navigate. So essentially, we were producing some high-quality books, but we weren't telling anyone about them. The information food chain, very standard, all of you here will be well acquainted with that. And at the top of that, obviously, the author was banging on at us. And we received a lot of negative correspondence when I first joined the RSC that I'm putting a lot of time into filling in marketing support forms, working with your teams, and for some reason no one's finding out about my book and the sales are not what I'd like them to be. So we re-evaluated the information food chain. And we thought this was how it should be happening, but when we looked a little bit closer, all of our print marketing and who it was being sent to, and when we were sending price updates and ISBN updates, it actually looked a little bit more like this. Funnily enough, there was a huge amount of confusion. People weren't even sure if we distributed our own books. We have fairly standard distribution agreements in the States and also in Australia, but that was causing massive amounts of confusion. And so we needed an opportunity to clean this up. And that was really where electronic came in. And I have used the dreaded E, but it really has been like that. We moved immediately in 2007, before we even launched e-books, to transmitting all of our bibliographic information electronically. We decided to join the digital revolution. We knew our journals were online, and we had bespoke professionals in-house who knew how to digitise. They digitised our archive. And we had a very focused in-house e-sales team. So we revamped our books website. We decided to offer all of our content online, and we wanted to integrate into associated RSC products. The benefits of e-books have been talked about a lot this afternoon, so I won't go through this slide, but this was essentially what we'd realised. The point we'd come to at the end of 2006 was we need to do this and we need to digitise quickly. And so the question was asked in-house, why? And these were the fairly standard responses that we presented. But we are a learned society, and every now and then we get frightened. And this was what we were really worried about. What's going to happen to our print? What's going to happen to our markets? What if we cannibalise our own market? What if investment costs don't throw us back the return that we're expecting? How do we approach data protection? And what are we going to do about data theft? And we were very, very concerned and had a huge number of very lively and animated discussions about this. But very much in line with the discussions from and the talk from Brian Bishop earlier from Springer, we took the opinion that if it's worked for journals, why wouldn't it work for books? So looking at piracy, being concerned about those hundreds of people out there who are into electronic chemistry e-books, we said, what approach can we take to tackle piracy before we go online? And we've come up with now a fairly comprehensive and quite straightforward policy where we regularly monitor all websites using Google Alerts, detecting sequential downloads from our own sites, and we work with other publishers. And a huge amount of this activity was happening for journals anyway, and we've just adapted it for e-books, and we took the approach that we would go with PDFs unrestricted online in big bundles. So we worked out we had the content, we can digitise it, we digitised our journals archive, we knew how to deliver it, we had a good website, we were able to tell people about it because we'd worked out the delights of sending Excel spreadsheets in the short term, and can we sell it? Well, we knew definitely we could sell it because we have a fantastic journal sales team who sell electronic products to librarians, and that's really what this market was all about for us. We managed to complete the archive digitisation in 6 months, and we focus very much on PDF files and XML headers. Now, in the context of the RSC, I have to add that we have a big journals department, and a huge amount of this work was done in correlation with our journals department. They understood the details of how do we put the PDFs online. We treated a book like a journal. Every chapter was an article, every book was a volume, and every series was a journal in its own right. And that was the structure that we then adopted. And we enhanced our bibliographic information and worked very hard on our in-house database to clean up the data. We have worked quite closely with Google throughout this whole program because for us, what we realised very quickly was visibility was what was holding us back the most. And so I'd re-emphasise some of the sentiments of the Springer talk earlier on, that we decided to go big, keep it consistent and follow things that we knew worked. The downloads really have been very dramatic. From day one of putting PDFs online, we realised that people liked e-books. And that alongside our journals, they're not where I'd like them to be, but they're certainly holding their weight against journal content. Key e-revolution aspects for the RSC have been Onyx data, and we wouldn't have been able to do what we've done without Onyx. We've got one person in-house who's actually here in the audience today who's worked incredibly hard to make sure that all of our bibliographic data was in a format that was readable semantically outside of the RSC. This allowed us to comprehensively present an online catalogue. Our database now runs our entire website. All of our catalogues and marketing is very database driven, which has saved us a phenomenal amount of time and actually meant that we've not had to invest hugely in getting extra staff in the short term. Print on demand, we suddenly went from a publisher who had a front list of around about 40 to 50 titles year on year to having an available back catalogue of over 800 books. POD sales statistics talk for themselves, and I'll come on to those a little bit later. And we started looking at e-marketing, things that were low in cost but quite high in return and really driving usage, and our entire emphasis has been about usage and visibility. And obviously, we created our e-book collection. This shift from paper to electronic has meant for us as a medium-sized or small to medium-sized book publisher that we've got the associated new business models. We can offer large library packages, which means we're getting in a lot of revenue at the beginning of the year, and we're not publishing a book and hoping that we're going to sell however many copies within 12 months. We can offer bespoke list marketing and sales activities because, again, it's very database driven. We spend a lot of time putting together emailing lists, but can then send out database driven emails to people. And it's enormously enhanced our visibility. And again, as I mentioned before, we've increased our product list using the on-demand technologies. So what this meant for us after we went online, and this, I'm just putting these particular stats up on the next slide, because they really surprised us. We're a UK-based publisher, but we know that a huge amount of our customer base is in the US for journals, and yet the US appears right down on number 6, and there's a slight mistake on there, Australia appears twice, sorry about that. But we could see immediately Australia and New Zealand for us were being almost untapped. If you looked at our print sales, we weren't shipping much down there, but people down there liked our content. Israel came up really high. There's a fantastic Institute of Chemistry, the Weizmann Institute in Israel. Their usage went sky high. They were one of the first to sign up. And so this was really important for us to actually re-scope and reassess what we thought about our own program in-house, who's reading our content. And as a membership organization, we tend to try and present content for our members, but it's not necessarily our members that are reading our publishing products. We immediately signed up to be inside of Google Book Search. We know from our journals program, from our website analysis, that 90% of everyone that comes to the RSC website comes in through Google. So that was really important to us to make sure that our books were completely inside Google. And we signed up for Search Inside, and there is a massive benefit to Search Inside. We get quite a bit of decent correspondence from Amazon on what's going on with Search Inside and how it's working, but they're not as good as Google at this point in time in terms of the feedback to us about what's going on. And we introduced new marketing tools. One of our editorial team is on Twitter. He doesn't have quite the same following as Lily Allen, but he's working on it. We have nano blogs. We've been trying to get our authors to start communicating, and we've actually found our authors have been quite resistant to that at this stage. It's been a bit of a challenge, but we're doing it, we're trying it, we'll give it a few more months. If it doesn't pick up, we'll just take it down. And we've also got all of our books available to mark on Facebook and also to add to Delicious and things like that. And what we're seeing is that the younger audiences that we've almost ignored previously, who are the undergrads and the postgrads, are now starting to engage with us at a level that's appropriate to them. And we haven't discontinued any of the traditional marketing that we would be doing to the academics, who are also an incredibly important part of our market. The results, by working with two key partners, you can cover 63% of search engine users and 39% of the online print book market, and these are Amazon and Google statistics. That's massively important as a small publisher when you're limited in not only the scope and in terms of staff, but also in terms of time. And that's meant a huge difference for us. But as we are a small player, we're incredibly aware that there are a huge number of other online print trade channels available. And we've used all of our electronic data to link into things like the Book Depository, the smaller booksellers, and also the niche booksellers. The results for the RSC, 2007 sales were up versus 2006, and our ebook sales actually constituted 10% of the total year's revenue. I made a couple of notes earlier that, you know, there have been different statistics from different publishers. Some publishers 1%, 15%, and 40%. These are all academic sales. We do not sell ebooks individually, so we follow very much that Springer model as we approach consortia and libraries, and we sell in. For the first time, I say, in about 6 years, we contribute a surplus, that's a profit for those of you from the corporate sector, to the organisation. And in 2008, we also have seen growth again. Print sales are up versus 2007. 9% of our total revenue came from print on demand, and that actually really shocked us. We've seen people buying books from 1968, books from 1972 that we really thought were finished. And ebook sales constituted 30% of the total revenue. So ebooks are incredibly important for us as an organisation. On the flip side of that, submissions also continue to rise, and we're really seeing growth in the programme overall as a result of going online. Very importantly, what we get from our ebooks programme is tangible results and statistics. By the end of Q1 2008, we'd seen huge increases of usage, and these are some of the examples of the Google analytics that we receive. But we also receive ebook stats from our own website. And ebooks, at the end of 2008, the usage was up 173% versus 2007. So we know that people are interested in our book program, and they're interested in the content in the way that we're delivering it at the moment. So what do I see, or what's the message I want to see for you guys to take away from my talk today? It's that we're really seeding the future. I don't think that what the RSC have done is particularly technologically innovative in the last 2 years, but what we've done is taken advantage of the market that is there, and behind the scenes we have a similar kind of lab in-house where they're working with books. We've put everything into XML. We are looking at the interfacing. Some of you may have heard of Project Prospect, and we're looking at how we can build books in a different format. But most importantly, we want to improve the culture of academic publishing, create a culture of listening to users and using the metric, using metric and analysis in everything that we do, embedding the feedback that we're getting from our customers in the way that they use our content into editorial sales, marketing, and product development. And also, we're being able, for the first time in a long time, to communicate directly with our customer base. But just refer back to the first slide that I showed about the information food chain. The publisher, in terms of academic books, is so far away from the reader that we really were almost just putting our thumb in the air and saying, we hope that you like this one, guys, and throwing it out into the market. This is giving us a real chance to see who's using what, what's getting the most usage, and what type of content is most appropriate. We're examining what people are using, how they're using it, very importantly, how they're finding it, and many people have alluded to that today. And we're understanding preferences, because there is rarely an aggregate average customer. And on that note, I'd want to just add in that I read recently that if you were to survey the temperature that people liked their tea served at, and you went out and asked everyone, you would find that probably 50% like iced tea and 50% like hot tea. So therefore, your marketing team would come back and tell you to produce a product which was lukewarm tea. And I think that's a really important element in terms of looking at metrics, being very conscious about what you're looking at, and not trying to second-guess the customer, but giving the customer the tools to develop the products going forward in the way that they want to. So we're focusing more closely at the RSC than ever before on our end customer. We're identifying the changing needs of the customers and buyers. We deal a huge amount with librarians. It's massively important to us to get things right, like MARC records and the tools that you need to then interface on with your end customer. And we're implementing feedback mechanisms throughout, offering the products with functionality that the users like the most. And our project Prospect, which is, again, it's an HTML full text linked into a whole number of different outside sources beyond the RSC, will hopefully see something really, really nice in the ebook world, which follows a not a million miles away model from the Wikipedia demonstrations that we saw earlier in the talk from Elsevier. So to conclude, ebook publishing, the revival of book publishing for small and medium-sized academic publishers, yes, I think so. And I think that academic publishers shouldn't be frightened to move forward and take advantage of the here and now. Whatever you do in PDFs, with the way that the market's evolving, will have either been forgotten in 10 years and you'll have missed that window, or you know there'll be some other enhanced PDFs so people wouldn't even look at your old PDFs. I think small publishers need to be bold and need to take advantage of what's out there. There's nothing that you can't outsource, is the other thing I'd say to that. We outsourced all of our XML tagging and all of our typesetting for our ebooks. And also, you can really increase flexibility and reach. You'll revive that older content that you in-house have probably written off, but your customers may not have done. And you can be far more responsive to customer needs than you'll have ever been before. And with that, I'd be very happy to take any questions on any of the points I've shown on the screen.
Question in the back. You're saying you're doing PDF at this point. Are you looking into producing other formats as well?
Yeah. What we've done is, for the digitization program, we digitized the entire backlog of publications to 1968 in PDF. We created XML headers for those. And then alongside that, from 2006 onwards, we integrated XML into our workflow. So for all of our front list books, we could actually move to HTML in theory at any time, and we do already have some in-house prototypes of linking between books and journals, which we've been looking at. But in the short term, what we've seen from based on the customer feedback is that people aren't ready for that yet, and they're quite happy with PDFs. And while we're still happy to exploit that market, that's the route we're going to stay on. But we'll continue. XML is everything we do now in terms of production. So we have everything tagged, and we're looking at the semantic markup for the text.
what's your overall revenues now for e-books? You said it was a business that was losing money in your journals business. Now, what part of your revenues currently do you see from e-book sales overall in journals, everything?
Oh, that's a good question. Testing my math skills. I say, relative to, journals is massive. To put it into context, the RSC total revenue for journals is well in excess of 20 million a year. So the books program is just too small really to be comparable. It's a smaller fraction of that, but it's holding its own weight. So I think that's probably the best way to answer that question. I'll work it out later in the meantime.
Caroline, I had a question as well. I think it's very interesting that you decided on a proactive policy regarding kind of piracy or DRM monitoring.
Yeah.
And that's been an issue for a lot of the publishers that we are working with. Can you tell us how you got to that and what your main criteria are?
The piracy that we were starting to experience was actually our editors and authors who were becoming quite irate. And they were finding things. Students were telling them about books that they'd found here, there, and everywhere. And so we had a sit down in house and we were like, what can we do? We did have a chat with several members of the STM organisation and also members of the ALPS organisation, and we're looking at what could we do, what are the approaches. And we found out very quickly that if you issue takedown notices, websites respond very quickly to that. We also worked, so not directly, but conversationally with Wiley, who have a huge team who are working on that. And we just tried to emulate some of the best practice that they had. And we share information where possible. So we scan, we have a few key offenders who we know will almost definitely start to put books up, which they shouldn't be. So I think the strategy was quite organic, but it involved a lot of talking to other people in the industry.
Do you have an example for one or two of your best practices that you've adopted?
It's probably better to let my colleague Merlin answer that, because he actually controls the e-book policy on piracy in-house.
Essentially, we receive Google Alerts every week. I set up Google Alerts that just say Royal Society of Chemistry and the name of a file-sharing website, be it RapidShare or megaupload.com. We then go through the links and identify live links and then issue by email a takedown notice to that website. And usually within 24 to 48 hours, that file has been removed from their website. And through doing that, we keep a log of everything on a spreadsheet. Ultimately, it's fairly simple, and we found it's been pretty effective so far this year. The number of unique titles appearing every week or 2 weeks has been in decline over the first quarter, but on the grand scheme of things, that's perhaps too early to see whether it's going to continually decline or there's going to be another peak in the future.
Thank you. We have time for one last question for Caroline, if there is. And if not, then thank you very much.
No problem. Thank you.